Hey, the future of the church is really with our Latino population. We'll talk with Rachel Campos-Duffy coming up next on Catholics Matter. Good to see you again on Catholics Matter. You know, the future of the church, at least in the United States, clearly seems to be with our Latino immigrants. And they go back two and three generations. But with us today, Rachel Campos-Duffy. Oh, Rachel, welcome. It's good to see you.
Thank you, Father.
You know what? Now, your mother is from Spain, and your father, actually, his ancestry is Mexican.
Mexican, born in Superior, right here.
Born in Superior, Arizona.
First generation he was,
yes, indeed. You know, tell us what that was like growing up, you know, in your household. I mean, common practices of the faith. What did you observe that were maybe distinctly Latino?
Well, you know, as in a lot of Catholic families, the mother is the matriarch, and she's the one that passes so many of the Catholic traditions on. And so her being from Spain, a lot of the things that we did were very much a part of her Spanish culture. And one of the things I think that was most fun for me growing up was that the nativity scene at Christmas time was a really big deal. And my mother, I mean, to this day, now that I have six kids of my own, and you know, I'm one of four, I don't know how she did it every year, but she would set up the entire city of Bethlehem with rivers and mountains, and I mean, it would take up, you know, all of this wall. And it was just, it was so magical, you know, as a child. And I have such very fond memories of the kind of care that she took to really bring the liturgical holidays to life for us and make them very meaningful.
Well, and actually, you know what, at least when I think of common practices in Spain, I especially think of like Holy Week,
mm-hmm.
You know, the parades, the passion plays,
sure,
and the like. You know, did she have you and all the kids play parts in those?
Yeah.
You know,
no, we weren't processing or anything. But you know, part of my childhood was spent in Spain because my father was in the military, and so some of those beautiful traditions that they had in Spain around Holy Week, I got to observe as a child, and so that was really great. But you know, the Mexican culture and the Spanish culture have so many things in common, obviously, you know, tamales at Christmas. I mean, there was no getting around that,
no.
You know, thank God.
Tamales at Christmas, getting a little straw from the manger.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
Little sign of prosperity there.
Mm-hmm. You know, and what I do with my kids around Christmas time is we have just a little basket with a baby doll of Jesus, and then we have a jar that I have straw in, and every time someone does a good deed, we put the straw under Jesus. And so over Advent, the idea is to provide, you know.
Now that is
that's really sweet, isn't it?
That really is. That's pretty, wow, you know, sowing seeds, you
yes.
know, right here.
You'd be
you know.
Amazed how many fights happen around, like, you know, the straws, unfortunately.
My deed was
yeah.
better.
Yeah. yeah
you know,
or
that,
you
that
didn't
merits
deserve
more
that straw. Yeah. But it really does. I mean, I think my mother really did do a good job of passing on to us the idea of the domestic church. And I think that's being lost, and we need to bring that back, especially because our culture is becoming so much more secularized. I mean, you can't count on your town to have a procession outside or for necessarily, you know, an entire community to come together and observe. I mean, look at the holidays, how horribly our culture has abandoned
well,
the
let
meaning.
Alone even a manger scene.
Hello.
You know, you would not even
it's
find
illegal.
It's illegal. You know, and that's why, you know, when I say, like, you know, the future of the church in the United States, I think is with our Latino immigrants, because clearly they have a very strong Catholic identity.
Sure.
But also, too, just the whole public practice of the faith is just, I mean, it in many ways it's incomparable, and it's affected so much you know, in the life of the church throughout the world. I mean, good heavens,
sure.
I mean, you know, the Holy Father, you know, is Pope Francis. He's,
sure.
You know,
sure.
He comes from Latin America. So, I mean, how would you see, you know, how would you see, I mean, well, actually, really, you know, growing up, I mean, as a teenager, what was your experience like going through Catholic school? Well, you didn't go through Catholic school, you went through public education.
No, I went to Seton Catholic High School in Chandler. So, you know, I did have a, you know, a pretty, you know, full, you know, home and school Catholic experience. I'll tell you what concerns me. What concerns me, and all the things you're saying about the Latino community are absolutely true. I mean, we are very faithful. We have beautiful traditions. We have enriched the life of the church in so many ways. But we're reaching a point where, I mean, you know, the African American community is out of wedlock births at 70%. We're now at 50%. And I think that so many things get lost when the family breaks down. And
disconnect is occurring here.
There is, yeah. There is. And it's hard to expect so many of these traditions and so much of the faith life to continue when the family is under such a strain. And so it is something I'm concerned about very deeply in our community, is that are we losing, we have a sense of family, but have we lost a sense of what that traditional family looks like, and also just how important it is to supporting all the values and the traditions and the faith that we have.
You know, it's sort of like identifying problems, but now finding solutions, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of, you know, how do we respond to that? And particularly, at least in my own experience as a priest, I very often found, you know, in parishes and in institutes where I've served, and particularly there is a strong Latino presence, they want to hear from another Latino.
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes the messenger matters, right? They
yes.
want to, but I think we need to speak the truth. I think a lot of times what we're seeing is a very huge influence of popular culture. The Latino community, whether they're first, second, or third generation, are no less immune to the forces of popular culture that are here in our country, but also in their own countries. And they're often influences that try to normalize things that once were, that are contrary to our faith, or even just not very functional, not very supportive of the kinds of faith life that we ought to have. And so, you know, there's a role for the church in calling that out and really holding, you know, the family up as the ideal, a traditional family, a mother and a father, and the importance of that. And sadly, I have to tell you, I think that from our government, there is a tendency to try to help through government programs that create dependency, and oftentimes accessing these programs, you're penalized if you do marry or you do. And so I think that there's a cycle there. And I also think that when you don't have a spouse, sometimes the government steps in and becomes the surrogate spouse, the surrogate father. And I think we're seeing some of these cycles happen and become normalized. And I think it's imperative for us as a community to really look back at what has made us strong. And that is the family. That is our entrepreneurialism, which we are, you know, known for, our hard work.
Sure.
But those things are always best and more beautiful in the context of family.
So then really, you know, even to take it one step further, as you know, the Institute of the Family, which, yes, I would concur, seems to be upheld on any number of different levels, but really marriage, because marriage is the backbone, of course, of the family and the Christian context and of society.
Absolutely.
And the Christian context, the Christian ideal of marriage is most definitely, you know, under assault. And you see this actually even occurring, you know, among our Latinos as well.
Absolutely. They're not immune. I mean, these forces are here, and in some ways it's affecting more. I mean, actually, white college educated women are more likely to get married and more likely to maybe, you know, have a traditional family. I think that oftentimes it is the poorest and the most vulnerable among us that are the most susceptible. And you can see why it would happen. I mean, you're poor, and I think oftentimes programs and things that seem helpful at first can create dependency, can take away and start to infringe and take more of the space that once belonged to the family. Now the government is doing more and more of those things, and we're losing those things.
Whereas really the perspective of the church would be solidly with the good and the welfare of the individual, you know, person in mind.
Absolutely.
First, prior to the government structure.
Subsidiarity, correct?
Exactly, you know, that really, that, that, my goodness, that's a discussion altogether in and of itself,
thing,
you know,
right?
But
sure.
You know, really, you know, now the future of, you know, the church, at least in our nation, you know, what do you see emerging, particularly because, you know, now you're in a very rural area of northern Wisconsin.
Yes.
But you also commute between there and Washington, D.C.
Sure.
You know, what are you seeing emerging there in northern Wisconsin?
What I'm seeing is that, you know, in rural areas, they're often a few years behind on what's happening, you know, in the church overall. What I see that's exciting in the church is that the younger generation, our younger priests, younger families are being drawn to the beauty of the traditional church, of a more Orthodox church. And I think it sometimes in the rural areas, it takes a while to catch up. I think when you go to places like Washington, D.C. and Virginia, you see a very robust and
good
full
word.
Churches. Yeah.
Good word.
And young people are really attracted to the beauty and all the aesthetics that of the liturgy, of the architecture, and the things that I think were lost. You know, when I was a kid, we started to see you know, Pizza Hut type churches. You know, they're sort of boxes and they all look the same. And I think my generation is really looking back and going, why did we lose those things? What happened? And so that's something exciting I see in the church. I see that the younger generations are drawn to that.
Robust.
Yeah.
What a great word. I mean, it can describe so much. Coffee.
Yeah.
most definitely. But there's always hope to be found in the young. And, you know, Rachel, thanks so much for joining us for this segment of Catholics Matter. And everyone, we'll see you the next time.
More shows can be seen on Faith and Life Television at faithandlifetv.com.